Alrighty. Good morning, class. My name is Eunice Reiser, and I will be your moderator for this morning. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. The school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various parts of the world. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word our Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord or God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by the letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We've drawn this cloud all around the edge of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this selfsame spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. The simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, What was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Our 10 primary constitution aims and objectives are as follows. 1, to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. 2, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. 3, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, a so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. 4, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures compared to religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. 5, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. 6, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. 7, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. 8, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. 9, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning, we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. And we will have a song in between. And our scripture lesson will be 2 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Thank you, all Father Yahweh, for giving us stability, happiness, and love. In this, I say one more time, I am thank you to Yahweh for keeping me in this time, in this age, and in good shape, the way he wants to. I cannot complain. I am happy for that. He still had me in this world, learning his purpose and his plan of salvation. I say all those things, and his only sign and his only son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, please reveal your Son in me. I want to love and please you for all eternity. Oh, Yahshua, my Elohim, won't you hear my humble cry? I'm begging for your mercy. Please don't pass me by.
If the good scarcely make it, who then can boast?
Yes, will never fail.
There's no time left to fake it. The end is much too close.
Yes, will never fail.
It's the time to look inward with hope and honesty.
Yes, will never fail.
Because Yahshua was able to cast out all vanity.
Don't give up. Believe in Yahweh's promises. Keep the faith. Yahshua will never, never, never fail.
You said seek and you shall find, ask and you'll receive.
Yahshua will never fail.
So I'm begging you, Yahshua, please put your Holy Spirit in me.
Don't give up. Believe in Yahweh's promises. Keep the faith. Yahshua will never, never, never fail. Don't give up. Keep the faith.
Stand up and fight for your right.
Don't give up.
He made a promise and he can never lie.
Don't give up.
Have faith in Yahshua.
Keep the faith.
His promises are real.
Don't give up.
He promised his spirit and he will never fail.
Have faith in Yahshua. Stand up and fight for your right. He made a promise and he can never lie. Have faith in Yahshua. His promises are real. He promised his spirit, and he will never fail. Heavenly Father, please reveal your Son in me. I want to love and please you for all eternity. Oh, Yahshua, my Elohim, won't you hear my humble cry? I'm begging for your mercy. Please don't pass me by.
Yahshua's been there. You are not alone.
Yahshua will never fail.
He is working to show you that you are not your own.
Yahshua will never fail.
All your trials and troubles prove that he is real.
Yahshua will never fail.
He will never forsake you, no matter how you feel.
Believe in Yahweh's promises. Keep the faith. Yahshua will never, 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 never fail.
Good morning, class. I will be reading 2 Corinthians third chapter. I'm reading from the King James Version, Scofield. 2 Corinthians, third chapter. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or need we, as some others, epistles of commendations to you, or letters of commendations from you? Ye are epistles written in our hearts, known and read of all men. Forasmuch as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of the Messiah, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the spirit of the living Elohim, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And such trust have we through Yahshua to Yahweh. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of Yahweh, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. But if the ministration of death, written and engraven in stone, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such a hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of which is abolished. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil, untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away with in the Messiah. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their hearts. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to Yahweh, the veil shall be taken away. Now Yahweh is spirit, and where the spirit of Yahweh is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, boldly beholding as in a glass of, I'm going to read that again. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of Yahweh, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as the spirit of Yahweh. 2 Corinthians, third chapter.
Thank you, Dr. Solis and Dr. Frizzell Mack. This morning is our regular class morning, and I would like to see if Dr. Samuel Solis would like to have something to say this morning.
Let me turn this off. There. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Here I am, thanks to Yahweh, in this wonderful place, the place of the highest learning. I am here to tell you things Yahweh wants you to know. We are living in perilous times. The world is shaking, and this is announcement for us to know the end is close. We had to think about. See, I say this is the place of the highest learning. There is a lot of things to learn. And I've been here in this class for so long, and I'm still learning. Mm-hmm. I never stop learning. And the most I read, the most I learn. Simple things, and those simple things are important things. We might look as they are simple, but they are not. See, I've been here for the grace of Yahweh. I've been here, I am here, not as the way I used to be. And I've been sick lately, but Yahweh keep me here in this place learning His purpose and His plan. And there is nothing new under the sun. Those things are all things, and we keep learning from all those things. See, we have here some charts allegorically. Those are pictorial illustration what is in the Bible. We are familiar with those pictures. We open the Bible and we read, we come up with these pictures in here. And was a man in the year 1931. He came with a vision. He came with a vision and a revelation. When he had the vision, next he had the revelation. So he was understand what the vision was about. And the vision he had, everything was about Yahshua the Messiah. This man we have here in this pictorial illustration, hanging in the cross, everything is about him. From the beginning, there is many beginnings. But one of the beginnings, I'm talking about the beginning of Moses. Moses, we know all the history of Moses. He was a little children chosen by Yahweh with a purpose and a plan. So as the founder of this teaching, Henry Clifford Kinley, Moses, you see in this illustration, also he have a purpose and his plan. He was a little baby, and he was thrown in the river. The daughter of Pharaoh picked him up and made him grow as a prince. He was doing pretty good. He was 40 years old. And looks like he make a mistake, but he didn't. Mm-hmm. It was purposed by Yahweh. Moses, he was 40 years old when he killed a man. He had to go away, far away, because Pharaoh, he might incarcerate him or put him to death. I don't know if it was accidentally, but Yahweh made him kill a man, and he buried the man. And he looked everywhere and see no one saw him, what he did, and he buried the man in the sand. The reason why he killed a man, because he was an Egyptian was beating a Hebrew. And Moses didn't like that. And he killed the Egyptian. But the man Moses helped was his brother, Aaron. Aaron went home. So Moses went home. He said, hey, nobody watching me kill the Egyptian. I am free. So he was walking as a regular day. He went to the place he buried the guy, and he looked down there. He said, he's there. The two Hebrews, they were fighting. And he was trying to separate them from fighting. And one of them say, who are you? Who made you a prince to be a judge over us? Right. When Moses hear that, he say, oh, everybody knows about what I did yesterday, but who was? Nobody watched me. But the man he saved to be beat is the one went over and tell his mom, Mom, a Egyptian was beating me, and Moses, he saved me, and he killed the Egyptian and buried him. But don't tell no one. And the mother said, yeah, I won. So she went to the neighbor and said, hey, you know, Moses killed a man, but don't tell no one. And, okay, I won. Pretty soon, next day, everybody knows about. So Moses, he had to go away, and he did so. He don't want to be killed, because who we killed, it was Pharaoh's son, somebody very important. If Moses killed a regular man, nothing can happen to him, because he was a prince. But he killed someone very important, so he had to escape. And he went far away. And he stayed there for 40 years, taking his father-in-law goats. And he married his daughter, Zipporah, Moses, and he had two children. He was very happy working for the father-in-law, take care of the goats. But look at how Yahweh planned all those things. He worked 40 years for free. And he escaped when he was 40. 40 is very, I can say, a number with a spiritual signification. Right. And he was so happy there. Being a prince and having the job of taking care of the goats. But he see a burning bush. And it was not a regular burning bush. Mm-hmm. It was a bush didn't consume. And most of the time, the bushes burn right away, but not this one. And he see something very particular in this bush, and he wanna know why the bush was not burning. And he tried to go around, and he hear a voice. Moses, Moses, take your shoes out of you, because the land you stand is a holy land. And he did so. And this burning bush, a voice came from there. It was an angel in there and told him, to go to back to Egypt and deliver his people, because the people, they were servants for 400 years. In the beginning, they have a beautiful life because it was a man, his name was Joseph, and he was the second of Pharaoh. That was the right hand. It's a long history. You all know about Joseph. He was the brother of 11 sons. And son of Joseph. And his brothers, because Jacob, he have 4 women, 2 wives, and 2 concubines. He have Leah, the first wife, and he have 2 concubines. The name were, cannot remember right now. It's, two concubines. And the second wife he have, the one he really want for wife in the beginning, it was Rachel. When Jacob see Rachel, he was in love with her, but he was very poor. He don't have nothing because he had to escape from his land because his brother wanna kill him. His brother say, when my father pass away, I will kill him. But Rebecca, the mother of both, hear that, he told Jacob, hey, you better go away from here because your brother wants to kill you. So he escaped and he went to a land with a man, Laban. He had 2 daughters. One was Leah and the other one was Rachel. He was in love with Rachel. And since he was very poor, he said, well, I can wait for you, for your daughter, 7 years. And you give it to me. Well, you don't have nothing. You are very poor. Yeah, you work for me for 7 years and I give it to you. The day came and he said, oh, father-in-law, 7 years already. Give me my wife. Okay. He make a big party, invite all the neighbors, and he got drunk. And he was drunk. They take him to bed, and he was in his bed. But his father-in-law gave him Leah. And he wake up and see her. He is not the woman he wants to. He said, why you did this to me? You tricked me. I didn't. The custom of this area or this place is the oldest marry first and the youngest marry later. But if you work for me for free for another 7 years, I give you the woman you want, Rachel. So 2 weeks after he married the first woman, Leah, he received the wife, Rachel, the one he wants to. But Rachel, she cannot give babies. And Leah, she gave 6 sons and 1 daughter, 7 in total. And Rachel was not so happy. Finally, Yahweh gave her a daughter, a son, excuse me. His name was Joseph. She was very happy. And the brothers of Joseph, They were very jealous because Jacob loved him so much because he was the son of the woman he loves, Rachel. And he made a tunic, a coat with a different colors, beautiful, and gave it to his son. And Jacob, he was a dreamer. He had a lot of dreams. And he told his brother, hey, I dreamed this, I dreamed that. And they didn't like what he dreamed. And one time, Jacob told Joseph, take this food to your brothers. They're working, take care of the goats this far. So he went. And when the brothers see him coming, he said, oh, here comes the dreamer. Because he told them, he had a dream when most of the 12 stars adore him. And they say, oh, that means you are going to be ruler over us? No, I just dreamed that. Even Jacob heard that. And Jacob didn't like it. And he said, Jacob, that means your mother and I had to bend over you? He went displeased. He went away. It's the only thing he said to him, to Joseph. Then Joseph went over to take the food to his brother. He said, oh, the dream is coming again. Now let's see what he dreams. But he gave the food, and he said, hey, let's kill him. And they said, one of them said, no, we better not have blood in our hands. Do something else. We can throw him in the hole right there with an open hole with water, but no water in there. So they throw him in there. Reuben say, no, we don't have to kill him. And some Ishmaelites, they were coming in camels. They were traders. And he said, we can sell him to these Bedouins and these people. Hey, we have a boy right there. We sell it to you. So they make an agreement and they sold Joseph. They take him to Egypt. And in the way, they went down there. And he was an Egyptian by him as a servant. But Joseph, he was very intelligent. And pretty soon, he was in the business of his of the boss. And he was very happy with him. He went away for a certain mission. But the man the boss have a wife. Joseph, he was about 18 years old, young man. And she likes him. And he said, Joseph, come over here. Give me a hand over here. So she make a few tricks and she refused to do what she wants to. But one day, she was alone by herself in the room. He said, Joseph, come over and give me a hand. And Joseph came to help her. He said, what do you want? He said, oh, come close to me in the bed. So she grabbed him and he said, oh, I cannot do this because my boss is good to me. Hey, come. And he refused and tried to go away. And she grabbed the tunic of him. And he runs and he was naked. And she started screaming. And all the servants came and, what happened to you, my lady? Joseph tried to seduce me. Look at, I have this robe in my hand. So they put him in jail for what he was trying to do. When the husband came, she said, oh, this job, Joseph, work for you? Look at, he tried to do something bad to me. But the husband didn't believe her because he knew her real good. So what happened, they put him to jail. And it was good in numbers and letters. And pretty soon he was helping in the jail, and he have a nice job. And he have a nice job, and pretty soon two men went to jail, the baker and the one served the wine. For something they did, Pharaoh put them in there, and they have dreams. And they say, oh, I have a dream. Me too, say the other one. And one say, what you dream? Well, there is a man over here. He know how to discern the dreams. Let's talk to him. And they say, Joseph, I have a dream. What you dream? I have this dream. He say, well, the dream he have. Oh, I know the meaning. What is the meaning? You will be free in 3 days. Oh, and the baker say, I have another dream. What you dream? I dream this and that. Oh, that means you will be killed in 3 days. Nah, that cannot happen. And the way Joseph say, this is the way it happened. The butler, he became free man. And Joseph say, when you free, remember me. I am not guilty. Okay, I will remember you. But the butler forget about him. He never remembered that. Till Pharaoh say, have had one dream. No magicians, no one wanna know how to solve the dream. And they call everybody who was a diviner. Nobody can come out with the answer. And the butler remember, excuse me, he was a man in jail, and he can solve the dreams. And he mentioned to Pharaoh, I know a young guy. He know how to solve dreams. Bring him over. So what happened? He was in bad shape. They put him a new clothes, give him a bath and haircut, and they present him to Pharaoh. And this is the man can solve your problem. Mm-hmm. And Pharaoh told Joseph, I dream this and that. I dream 7 fat cows and 7 skinny cows. And the skinny cows eat the fat cows. Oh, that's easy. Can you solve this problem? No, it's not me. It's my Elohim. He's the one. Tell me the meaning of these dreams. That means you will have 7 years of plenty, and 7 years it will be chaos. No food at all. Oh, what can I do to solve this problem? Oh, this is very easy. You can make a big containers and save some of the produce 7 years. By the end, you will have a lot of crops saving. But who can do these things? You, Joseph, you are the one. You can be in charge and do this job. Okay, and from on, have my ring. You will be the most powerful man in this kingdom under me. I will be the most powerful, and you are be the second one. And Joseph built a lot of containers for the grain, 7 years of plenty, and Pharaoh take 5% of the produce and save it. After 7 years, no rain, no crops, and the people started hungry, and they went to Pharaoh. He said, Pharaoh, we are dying. Give us some of the crops you saved. And I said, well, I will sell you what you need. So he sell in the beginning, the first year, for gold and silver. And the second year didn't rain again. He said, Pharaoh, we need food. Well, I can sell you crops. We don't have no more money. Well, give me your goats and your cows and your horses. Okay. And the third day, year is, no rain, no food. Well, give me your ranch, the papers of your ranch. Okay, here. And Pharaoh gave them food, Joseph. And Pharaoh ended very super rich. And the people very, very poor. And this is the what I've been learning. Pharaoh, he became so rich, and the people became so poor. They overthrew Pharaoh and have another Pharaoh. But that Pharaoh, he don't have no respect for Joseph's descendants. Because Joseph, by that time, he was already dead. And he put the Hebrews as slaves. You will make bricks, and I will build cities with your bricks you make. So the lifestyle of them started changing. Because in one time, they live where the river Nile go into the Great Sea, and the delta, many rivers went to their big sea. And they were green, and animals, they were in good shape and strong, and they multiply big time. And Pharaoh didn't like that. Because the Egyptians barely give a birth to the kids. And the Hebrew ladies, they give birth every year. And Pharaoh say, we better do something. Because these people start multiplying the way they doing, pretty soon they might take over. Or if someone try to fight against us, they can, the Hebrews can enjoy join them, and they can defeat us. So Pharaoh say, he gave a decree, kill the babies, men, and save the women. And he told the ladies, the one help for the burden, kill the babies, boys. And the girls, the women, they didn't do that. Because the women, they were afraid of Elohim. Mm-hmm. Since Pharaoh see that, he give the order. He said, kill to the soldier. Kill every male and throw it to the river, Nilo. And they start to doing that. This way, the Hebrews didn't multiply, or multiply in a slow way. And this teaching is a long teaching, more than a life span. And I just tell you a little bit about history I read in the Bible, and I read and I hear in this class, because to me it's very beautiful and important how things develop in there. Same way in our life. Our life is very important and beautiful. If we just take a time and review our life, it's impossible, looks like, but Yahweh take care of us for a purpose and a plan. And after I tell you about the history of Joseph and his family, it's a long history, believe me. I'm going to tell you. There is many beginnings. beginnings of Moses. Here we have Moses. This is the beginning. The beginning with Adam in the garden. And beginning, this is a beautiful beginning of Elohim. Elohim is being shown here for us in a vision and a revelation. But the father of Elohim is Yahweh. Is manifest as a cloud because it's inscrutable and incomprehensible. Nobody sees the Father at any time. We have here intelligence, knowledge, wisdom, love, beauty, foundation, power, justice, and strength. Those are cosmetics of Yahweh. How we can perceive Yahweh, attributes, invisible. This is the way he joined himself. We can see those attributes in people too, because Yahweh is in every one of us. Right. Yahweh manifested himself in a physical body, Elohim. Is only being seen in a vision and a revelation. Then he manifests himself in a physical body as Adam. And he manifests himself as Yahshua. And one time his name was Oshia. And also, he manifests himself as Yahshua, as the world called Jesus Christ. This is very important for the new, the ones watching this video. The world called him Jesus Christ. It's impossible. Impossible. Because the letter J was and is not in the Hebrew alphabet. The letter J was found in the 13th century and appeared in the English alphabet in the 17th century. This is the way the Hebrews used to write the name of the Creator, Yahweh, YHWH. From right to left, Elohim and Yahshua. Well, I start walking very funny. But tell me, those names are the original ones. Yahweh, pure spirit, taken a shape and form of a man, Elohim, and is manifest himself. Not physical, but in the physical, Yahshua the Messiah is the same spirit in two manifestations. One, two. To understand this is not complicated, but you have to put attention. Nobody sees the Father, but he manifests himself as Elohim. And manifested himself as Yahshua the Messiah. One, two, three. As simple as that. And everything is one, two, three. There is nothing is not one, two, three. Just name it. Cell of atom. One, two, three. Simple as that. See, this is the way I remember our founder used to teach us every day, and some people say, Why all the time go to this same chart and speak about Moses? Some say we are tired of that. But all this teaching is here. This take our picture. I've been hearing this for a long time. Our life, we think about this tabernacle. 1, 2, 3. Head cavity, chest cavity, and abdominal cavity. Same as the physical body. The physical body is head cavity, chest cavity, and abdominal cavity. This physical body fits in Moses and the body. Head cavity, chest cavity, and abdominal cavity. All those organs fit in the tabernacle. The function of these organs fit in this tabernacle. This tabernacle was given to man in the year 1490. When Moses was taken to the third heaven, we have three heavens, space, atmosphere, and eternity. 1, 2, 3. And three heavens, and everything is 1, 2, 3. You see Moses' vision? 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. This tabernacle is a heavenly thing because Yahweh gave the specification how to build. Not because Moses have a big memory. Yeah, he was educated. When somebody is being educated, he assimilate a lot of instructions. He probably gave him the instructions how to build this tabernacle. But it was too much. How to build, how to construct. The ability was from Yahweh. Yahweh put everything, he showed him, he put him in his head. And he came over and explained what he wants to Bezalel and Aholiab, and they built this thing. Before they built this tabernacle, it's a heavenly dimensions. Yahweh gave another dimension also, Noah's Ark, heavenly dimensions. And also, he gave another dimensions, how to build Moses' temple. It was a beautiful temple. Right. One time, it was dedicated in the year around 1000. And served its purpose for almost 500 years. But this was destroyed. See, one point. If this tabernacle over here, the bell can be torn from the top to the bottom, that's right. You cannot see anything in there. Impossible to see something. Why? Because they were boards of acacia with gold. They were covered by gold. That's cool. So nothing you can see in there. But, and this one, yeah, it was a time for. It was a time when this veil is being written. You can see in it or understand. Because Yahshua the Messiah, he was crucified, he saved his purpose. He came, this man, with the order of Yahweh, nothing else, to fulfill, perform, complete, and bring to an end this law. The law was given to Moses. He is the one who received this law for a certain time only. But they had to be changed because this law was only of blood, killing, offerings, physical. There's a type and a shadow. That way, the new law can understand. You need something physical to understand the invisible. All the time. If a little boy never see a car, you tell him a car, he don't know. But you show him a little car, and you show him a big one, he say, hey, make a correlation. Oh, this is a car. Even you don't tell him, no need to tell him, that is a car. Because you see the little one, a type and a child. This teaching is very wonderful. The more you see, the more you have things to talk about. But I can see I'm not too steady right now. So I want to take my seat and give the opportunity to somebody else to keep going with this teaching. Thank you very much, and have a good one.
Hallelujah.
Bye-bye.
Hallelujah.
Yes, it may.
Thank you very much, Dr. Salas. Do you? Our next speaker for this morning or this afternoon will be Dr. Aaron Alanese. Oh, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good afternoon, class.
Good afternoon.
It's good to be here. Wow, I thoroughly enjoyed Dr. Samuel Salas. Recanted a little history about Joseph, which was the 11th born of Jacob. We had it on the monitor for a little bit, showing the two two maidservants of Leah's, Zilpah and Bilhah. You remember now, right? Yeah. Ha ha ha. And we had, I think, someone on Zoom also posted the correct names as well. And this is what we are at a school. And Dr. Samuel Salas gave a beautiful lecture in regards to the things pertaining to Yahshua the Messiah, as he said that Dr. Kinley had a divine vision and revelation about Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Straight from Yahweh himself. You follow? Didn't work up on it. Didn't contrive anything to make himself to be anything. He died a pauper. He had opportunities to have been in the mainstream, if you would, and to make millions as some of the other fake theologians that are out there, but yet because of the will of Yahweh, he kept this teaching as it is, and as we endeavor to speak the gospel of Yahshua Messiah, not only here, but there's a few other classes around the country, around the world that preaches to the same drumbeat that we were given, and as Dr. Samuel Salas expressed here today, as far as the things that pertain to the beginnings, as Dr. Samuel Salas talked about. He talked about there's many beginnings, and that oftentimes there's three that I am privy to. But then Dr. Samuel Salas did say that there is a beginning, and there's a way to go into your Bible and begin to read it, and there's the beginning is with Moses. You follow? Luke 24, 25 expresses that Yahshua the Messiah, after he had risen from the tomb, speaks to two on the way to Emmaus and lets them know that they're fools because they didn't believe in what all the what the prophets and what Moses had wrote about him. You follow? Prior to that, John 5:40-ish, he's talking to the scribes and the Pharisees. He lets them know that they don't have a heart or a love of Elohim in them. You follow? Because they didn't believe what Moses wrote about him. You follow? And we recant these scriptures over and over again. Just go ahead and grab John 5. I think it's around 40. You can see, because this is a school, this is not a Bible quote and scripture reading contest. You know, that's always intimidated me as a young child being in the school. I didn't know in the life of me how they were able to remember so many scriptures. You follow? And lo and behold, I'm remembering scriptures. As I sort out, we're going to be able to do that. Yeah. It goes into a testimony about Yahweh going to make you do what he will you to do. Regardless, yes. You follow? Dr. Samuel Salas, I love him to death. But, you know, to be in our predicament and having the labor that he labored in order to demonstrate to you about this name. You see, this is a name. These aren't names. This is one name. Right. See, this is Yahweh is salvation. He don't have a little son separate from him. That is Yahweh, and he's your salvation. See, this Elohim is not a name. It's a title. Right. So therefore, we're dealing with one name, and that name is Yahweh. Huh? Yahweh is salvation, coming in the likeness of sinful flesh some 3,500 years ago, starting from the day, tarried on earth for 33 and a half years. In a physical body named Yahshua. After he ascended, he's not separate anymore.
Yeah.
So that's why I say this is a name. These aren't names and a title. This is a name. I said a name. A name, meaning one, singular. You follow?
Right.
And Dr. Samuel sort of labored to let you know that these are characters that they wrote in Hebrew from right to left at a period of time. You follow? And in order to make these pronounceable, you have to understand how to pronounce it. This tetragrammaton, Wah-He, is pronounceable through an understanding of those who wrote Hebrew. You follow? And that is Yahweh. You follow? Now, they weren't dealing with Adam and dealing with the Eve, right, as it were. But they were dealing with an understanding that Yahweh had put in them. You follow? From the time of Moses, Abraham, Joseph, that went down into prison for a false accusation by a centurion's or one of Pharaoh's officers.
Yeah.
You follow? Mm-hmm. The officer's wife kind of made a false accusation against Joseph, saying that he came, went in there and slept with her. You follow? That's over there in Genesis, the 39th chapter, if you're inclined to read about what Dr. Samuel Salas. See, he ain't come up with nothing new, Dr. Samuel Salas. He read the book. Go to chapter, open up the book and go to chapter 37 and read. All of what he paraphrased is right there. He's not he's not mystically expounding upon anything new other than having read it.
Right.
And been recanted it to us. Mm-hmm. It's nice to sit back and hear the words from somebody tell us about it. That's great. But read for yourself, right, so you know it. You follow? 37, keep going to 38 and 39. And 39, you talk about this prisoner who put Joseph in prison. You want to know how he got in prison? Because, hey, why? Because there's a death, there's a burial, and there's a resurrection principle all the way through all of these stories. Dr. Samuel Salla said that this whole book, and Yahshua said himself, is all about him. Who put the blue up here? He said this whole book is all about him, Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Yahshua the Messiah, to know him, you got to know how. You got to know how he died. You got to know how he was buried and how he resurrected according to the scriptures. And that's plural. We're talking about scriptures, which are the law and the prophets, which is the righteousness of Yahweh. Dr. Samuel Salla started off with Moses, you see, talking about his mother down here in Egypt. And they were populating, and there was a death decree. You see, that's a death principle according to the law of Moses. There was a burial principle when the mother put Moses in the ark. That's the burial principle. See, when Pharaoh's daughter retrieved or drew Moses out of the River Nile, which was a resurrection principle. You see, that was the spirit in Moses. Because it reads over there in the second chapter, I believe, of Genesis, of Exodus, talks about Moses was a goodly child. You follow? And now when you understand and take the significance and the sincerity of what was put in the book and what's remained in the book, I understand there's mistranslations, interpolations, and there's errors in the book. I fully, dearly understand that this is not perfect. It's not the original Hebrew script. I get that. And even if it was, I wasn't going to be able to read it anyways. But what I do believe in is that Yahweh don't make no mistakes. And Yahweh is going to put in what he's going to leave. Look at me. Look at anybody around. We're walking, breathing, talking, eating, doing what we do. We may appear to be perfect. Look at some of those people who do exercises. They got a beautiful body, and some got money, and they just like the, but they are sick inside in some fashion, because everything fleshly is bound for the grave. It's not perfect. We put makeup on, we do our hair, we shave, we shower to be presentable. But you're going to always find something. I had some marks on my shoes. I said, damn it, these shoes, I don't want to get them dirty. And you know how it is. You get a new pair of sneakers and someone steps on them the first time they do. You get a little upset with that, trying to keep them clean. Because it's not perfect. Yeah. And even if you thought they was perfect when you was wearing them before, they were still defective somewhere. A thread is off. You know, the soul inside was off. May not be able to see it, but, you know, people primp themselves. There's a fault somewhere in the flesh. So, therefore, I don't have a problem with there being a fault with the Bible. But now what Yahweh or this school has shown us is that we can pick it out. And we can either put it to the side or that we can include it. And say, I include that goodly child. He didn't take that out. King James didn't take that out. A.B. Trainer didn't take that out. You follow? A.B. Trainer took out 1 John 5 and 7, he took that all the way out, took two verses all the way out the book. Yeah. But we still use in the Holy Name Bible. You follow? Nevertheless, that goodly child died during the, you know, that goodly child shows forth the death principle, the burial principle, and the resurrection. Hey, Dr. Samuel Salla is talking about Moses when he was 40 years old. What's the significance of 40? Huh? Come on, man. We got a chart. We got a pattern we go by, right? You got six steps. That fourth step is the door. You follow that? And you see this lower part or the abdominal area or the core roundabout? That's Egypt. Or that's your world. You follow? And that fourth step is the door. So therefore, why 40 when he's down here killing that Egyptian? Because he's killing that satanic spirit. He's killing that satanic spirit here. And he's burying it back in the earth. Because that's what he said when he come out of this ground. That's where he's going to return to. And he's going back into this ground, that sand. and buried. And then when Dr. Samuel was talking about this, he said he turned left and right. Well, hey, don't you turn. Just cross here. You got left, you got right. You got this fourth day here on this creation according to Moses' vision. You got that fourth day, that sun coming. You got a left, you got a right. You see, you got a dispensation here that Yahshua Messiah has come in on this fourth dispensation. You got a left, you got a right, because he's fulfilled it all. That's why Moses looked left and right.
Yeah.
Now, Moses said he didn't think nobody saw him, but someone did see him. Someone had to have seen him in order to give a report for him to move on up out of that fourth door, that fourth step, into the holy place. And that's what he did when he came out to the land of, into the land of Midian, right? And he came right over here and tended to Jethro's flock of sheep. And he came to this burning bush. There's your light principle. Huh?
Yep.
Now he's working in the holy place of this town. Moses alone, because, hey, Moses don't know the name of the creator. They know him as El Shaddai or some such name or title, as it were, but did not know him as Yahweh. Now we're starting that beginning here. You're going to come all the way out and come all the way back down into Egypt. And by the mighty hand of Yahweh, Moses is going to be the pawn or the vessel. Just like we all vessels. Mm-hmm. Expounding upon the things of Yahweh in order to help save those who are in the fire. Now, if you're out of the fire and fine, be that. Help another. Mm-hmm. Share. Bring about the gospel in its simplicity. Mm-hmm. You follow? Don't get all esoteric as some of our brothers seem to want to do when they want to jump on over here and skedaddle up out of this earth plane as though they've become immortal all of a sudden. No, we are in the flesh. You listening to the news. You had a bowel movement this morning. You had to wash your face. You had to eat. You had to do all sorts of physical things. You are not immortal. You follow? There's no big eyes and no that. If someone was immortal, were able to walk through wall, if someone manifested through this wall right now, we all would be amazed.
Yeah.
That would be a big eye to me. Mm-hmm. But if a person comes through these doors, they just like me.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? That's immortal. You able to come through walls and whatnot. That's a special power for that. I get that. But coming through the door, no. And everybody who say that they over here in this immortal state or this seven new earth state, they coming through the door just like I did. And until I tell them, when you come through this wall or go out that wall, I listen to what you got to say.
You know?
Yeah? That's enough of that. Nonetheless, Dr. Samuel Salas said, you starting here with Moses, and Moses had to get this name. And this started, right? He had to get that word from Elohim. Mm-hmm. Here. That's that manna, or that's that food, or that's that loaves, or that bread. And Yahweh would say, I'm going to be with you. Didn't he say when he went down there? Because Moses was scared.
Yeah.
Moses needed some re-encouragement, as we all do.
Mm-hmm.
He's bringing it down to earth, as some of our brethren want. This to take off the chart and put it all on ourselves. And we want to express that to you, that you need to be encouraged. And we try to express to you that Yahweh's with you.
Right.
We try to get you to see that Yahweh is with you. Because this is what Samuel Salah said, that all of this is about getting to know who Yahweh is.
Mm-hmm.
By his son, Yahshua the Messiah, the manifestation. You follow? Because he manifested. Yahweh, pure spirit, Samuel Salas beautifully said there that in John 1:18, talking about no man has seen the Father, you follow, save the Son in this sonship degree. And the Son's going to deliver to whomever he wills to deliver it to, you follow. But you have to seek, you have to knock, you got to want to know, you follow, you got to believe. See, what is it, the beginning of understanding is belief in Yahweh? You have to believe that Yahweh is. And then this is what I was saying, that intercessor, because Yahweh said, Yahweh Elohim said that I will be with you when you come down here. And I'm going to show Pharaoh my power and my strength. You follow? And though this is the reason why Moses come back down here and going to bring the children of Israel out. And they're going to tarry here for 40 years. Huh? In the wilderness. As 40 years, got to come all the way down in each one of these plates. 40 principle in order to see the principle of the pattern of Yahweh. Because you got to go through something. This holy place is the fifth step. You got to get through the door. Like when Moses did at 40 years old, he had to kill off that flesh. It's going to get buried, and he's going to resurrect. He's going to become the man after another 40 years, though, because that's a transition. Mm-hmm. He's going to have to, hey, when Yahshua Messiah, after he ascended or resurrected, he stayed on earth for 40 days.
That's right.
Then he had to transition, mm-hmm. and he ascended into heaven.
That's right.
You couldn't make out hide no hair of him. Mm-hmm. You follow? But he comes back in that same form as he went away, which was spiritual. And he came back into their hearts and mind. And see, people get messed up by that. But you lucky the Bible a little bit askew, because you have even more things wrong. Because remember, when Yahshua Messiah, after he tarried on earth for 40 days, he went away. And there's two angels, they're looking at the apostles, or the disciples at that time, asking them, why are you staring? Why are you looking up? And so now you got the whole world reading that, and they're all looking up. And we'll get that too in a minute. Read what I had you to get right quick.
John
5:45. Okay, 5:45.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
See, now this is Yahshua talking to him. Talking about, don't think I'm going to accuse you to the Father. I just said, no man know the Father save the Son. And he let him know that he going to accuse him to the Father. Mm-hmm. But what?
There is one that accuses you, even Moses, in whom you trust.
See, they trusted this Moses here. This is why this Moses chart is named Moses chart, because it's very important.
Yes.
Because not even is Yahshua going to accuse you unto the Father, Moses, in whom you trust, going right. to accuse you of not knowing his Son. Because mm-hmm. you can't know the Father unless you know the Son. Mm-hmm. And Yahshua is letting you know that you don't know this Moses chart. Are you tired of this Moses chart or tired of Moses? Then you got a big problem. Mm-hmm. If you're not going to come back and refer to the things of Moses, to somebody that don't know. Now, if they know the gospel, you can scatter on a little bit up the road a little bit. Don't get lost in your imagination, but you can scallywag up the coast a little bit and learn about some things. But are you talking to someone new that don't know, that's a babe, whether they're from your loins or not, or they've been in Bible study school somewhere else or not? I'll just stop shaking my head. Don't matter. They got to circle back and start at Moses. Just as Yahshua, read it. This is what Yahshua said to them. They believed Moses.
For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me, for he wrote of me.
Mm.
But if ye believe not his writings, mm-hmm. how shall ye believe my words?
Oh, I just say, if you don't know about this Moses chart, how are you going to know about Yahshua the Messiah? That's what Yahshua just said out of the book. Yeah, I've just got a chart here and said the same thing, unbeknownst to me. But if you don't believe Moses' words, how are you going to believe him?
Right.
How are you going to know Yahshua if you're not going to believe Moses? Mm-hmm. And if you can't come run a line on Moses and help a person out to know how this is a pattern in threes, 1, 2, 3, that's Dr. Samuel Saul's beautifully state. It's not hard, but it can't be boring either, because this is our life. This is because we're patterned after Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading a little bit.
And the Jews marvel, saying,
mm-hmm.
How knoweth this man letters, having never learned?
That's why they say, that's why we say, Dr. Kennedy only had a sixth grade education. We bring that out. We bring these points out. Just as Dr. Kennedy was accused, just as Joseph was accused of sexual relations, as it were, but found out later it wasn't so. You follow? Remember, that's Genesis, the 39th chapter. You want to know about that false accusation. You can read it in the book. We don't have time to go over every jot and tittle. This is a school. This is a research school. You follow? But keep reading.
And Joshua answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me.
It's the doctrine that Saul said that he received, which is how the Messiah died, how he was buried, and how he was resurrected. That's 1 Corinthians 15 chapter. You ought to know it. Verses 1 through 4. You follow? That'll get you to what the doctrine is. Someone asks you, what doctrine do you speak? You speak 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, verses 1 through 4. And that just nails everything in the book. There's no other conversation to talk about.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what the scriptures are, and you better not start at the so-called gospels neither. You follow? This is what we study. This is what we use to armor ourselves, because you're going to have to fight. You're going to have to say something. Yeah, to somebody about Yahshua, not about your story, about what you know, what got you through today,
right?
But what got you through, which was Yahshua the Messiah,
right?
That was in you, if you believe the report. Because remember, it was funny when she just read there about they believe in Moses, whom ye trust,
right?
But he said, but if you had believed Moses, then you would have believed me. So he's the way he's looking at it. They didn't believe Moses. That's the sum of it. They didn't believe Moses. They read you, and you know darn well that everybody done read that Bible and they changed that Bible to fit their cause. That's why you got so many different Bible versions, and people bellyache over which version is the best version. Well, they're all wrong, essentially. King James is the one that we deem most accurate, as it were. The Holy Name Bible, it stems from the King James Bible. But it's still both got errors in them. You follow? So you're going to have to know about the principal aspects of the teaching about Yahshua the Messiah that we teach here. And there's no one else on earth plane that teaches it. Bar none. Harvard, Cornell, Yale, all of these paramount schools don't have nothing on the ability to teach about the creation of the heavens and of the earth. You follow? Whereby a man could be stable-minded in the gospel, in the doctrine of what they can receive as a free gift if you open up your heart and mind and receive. Go ahead. That's good with about Moses and why we starting with Moses. Go ahead and flip through Luke 24, I think it's 40. Let me 25 too.
Yeah.
Do 25 first, and we'll skip down.
Okay. Luke 24:25.
Now this is Luke 24:25. This is Luke that's writing a biography about Yahshua Messiah and the things that he was told that Yahshua Messiah said. That's correctly put. Now this is Yahshua after he's resurrected. Okay. Mm-hmm. Read.
Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart.
Those are the two boys that he was walking with after his resurrection, after they had just crucified Yahshua Messiah. They're going back to their homestead. And Yahshua them popped up on them.
Mm-hmm. Boop.
Now he's immortal now. He's immortal.
Right.
Yahshua popping up and popping out of things before they can stone him type of thing. Mm-hmm. You follow? Now he have that ability, that power of transmutation, of not being subject to the earth plane, because he is the son of Yah. He is Yahweh himself, willing his will in a body or out of a body. That's what we say in our moderation.
Right.
I'm not making it up. He transformed from out of pure spirit in part, not in totality, as Elohim. And now after his resurrection, he's no more a man on that cross walking around like you and me. He is Yahweh in a body appearing to whomever he may appear or show himself to. That's the point we're getting at. Not everybody saw him walking around kicking it for 40 days. Only the people he allowed.
Right.
Just like we say, you can only stand, you can only understand this Elohistic superincorporeal being if he allow you to see the revelation. See it or see the revelation. Only he gonna allow it. Someone that's on Zoom said, wow, I never seen that certain aspect of whatever it was that they had saw. And it's like a wow. Yahweh allowed you to see it today. You've been in all this time. You've never seen it before. And someone said, just like I said today, myself, I use myself as an example. I never thought about why Moses looked left and looked right. But I can put it on a pattern that that's Yahweh in a body working through Moses, killing that man. And then he's looking left, he's looking right over the work he about to do. Huh? Because him getting on the cross, because we're saved by the blood of Yahshua the Messiah. That blood of understanding is what you got to understand, because that's the witness on earth. The blood, the water, the spirit, 40, ascension. You started with blood first. So you can't skip up here to spirit. That's why you got all those spiritualists out there now thinking you're going to get some sage and clap your hands and spin around three times and got you doing all kind of smoking toad poison and getting you high on the Burning Man event and trying to get you psychedelically involved into a spiritual reality. Nah, you got to come back down and deal with the blood. The death of the thing, the death of the matter was you.
Right.
Yeah. There's no quick way in around this tabernacle to jump in out of. You got to come in through the gate, my friend. Right. And that first, or that second step is an altar there. And that is an altar of death. Mm-hmm. You see? And then certain of the teachers talk about this grate. Zoom in on this grate here. Let you know that this grate or this altar of sin sacrifice, that's the world. That's going to be consumed. You follow? Because this fire never went out in this altar. And you got these grates here, right? That grating system is like our longitude and latitudes on this earth plane. And it's doomed to cook you and me up on this earth plane. Yeah. Your body going to go into the ground, but you're going to have to be in repose. Them people that passed away, they're not ripping and running nowhere. They're staying repose. They're staying right where they locked cocked. Nothing they can do. They can't fix nothing. They can't explain nothing. They're stuck. You got Lazarus and the poor man. That story. Lazarus talking about it's hot down here. Can I have Moses give me some water? Moses can't do nothing. Moses asleep. Lazarus is a rich man. I don't know where that's at. Mm-hmm. I don't have you getting nothing else, right? We're done with that. Luke. Finish Luke. Luke. Yep. Okay. They're on the road to Emmaus. Yahshua pops up on them, and he says what?
Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
All the prophets have spoken. That's part of the scriptures. Read.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and enter?
Ought not. A-U-G-H-T, ought not. That's a big word, ought. We're going to get into that big word over the next couple of weeks. Ought not. But go ahead.
To have suffered these things and to enter into his glory.
See, the Messiah said he was supposed to have done these things and entered in. He told his disciples that he's going to have to do it. So ought not, we know and believe that you not going to get on that altar?
Yeah.
Don't you know that you're going to get on that altar too? Ought not you know that you're going to have to die to death? You got to look to the blood. You can't jump up there in spirit and get high and think you can multiply and be like Yahweh. No. You can't even be like Michael Jordan. I won't be like Mike. There's only been one Mike. Huh? I used to go buy the shoes of Michael Jordan. thinking I'm going to be able to touch the, just barely touch the rim. If I was able to dunk, it was a special day. But it wasn't when the time was needed. I couldn't do the clutch shot. I didn't get recruited by the NBA. I can't be like Mike. There's only one Mike. There's only one you.
That's right.
There's only one me. You follow? And we're not trying to act like Jesus neither. We're trying to learn of Jesus so that he can change that vile body.
Right.
He's trying to change that heart. As we read in 2 Corinthians, the third chapter, we'll get to before we end today. But that's what we want to become. You follow? Mm-hmm. Yeah, we want to become that in reality, in our consciousness. Not faking or funking or faking the funk. We want to be that. We want to know that it's Yahshua. And he does it as like osmosis. Right. You learn of him, he take away your problem. That's where it is. You can't fix your problem. You don't know what your problem is. So if you just learn of him, as you learn and believe in the faith of what he's doing, he's removing your stuff. That's how it is. And it's an invisible work. He's taking the physical things that he got you in, got us in and into the trick bag. When I say you, I'm including me too. Don't get me twisted as though I'm trying to speak down. I'm just trying to let you know that it is Yahshua that set us up to be in the predicament that we're in.
That's right.
And we didn't have a sense enough to not do it.
That's true.
Until we started getting some sense and said, maybe I not drink so much. Yeah. Or maybe I not smoke so much. Maybe I not spend all my money unwisely so much. These are things we just physically, we come into a reality of learning time management and health and all of that we just do. But that ain't coming into a knowledge and understanding of Yahweh. Sure. Mm-hmm. It's two different things. It parallels. Just like that old boy Satan, it parallels. You got a ride of you got the same as you hear in righteousness as you have over here in unrighteousness. Mm-hmm. It's still a man. It's still an appearance, and you can't discern the difference until you learn about Yahshua. Mm-hmm. And when you learn about Yahshua and you start doing the things of Yahweh and obeying the things of Yahweh, you become Yahweh. You don't become high-minded and wanting to sit on the throne like this character displayed. Mm-hmm. You follow? When iniquity was found in him. Remember, he started off in Eden, too. Mm-hmm. And those little innocent babies that are born, they innocent. They beautiful. But they're going to become just as wicked and disordained and unawares unless you teach them. And that's your job, is to teach your children. That's why we say, when you know the story of Moses and know how to run it and know the principle of blood, water, and spirit and the death, burial, and resurrection, when you know, you got to teach. You got to teach old men, young men, new men. That's what we do. That's what he's raised his school up for, is to raise able-bodied ministers to minister the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, which is Yahweh's. You follow? They're not separate. That's all Yahweh working. Mm-hmm. And we use Yahshua so that we have some pattern to go by. And we understand that pattern. See, the world got it twisted as though there's a Trinity. You see, unless you know how to explain a Trinity and express that a Trinity is not even in your Bible, number one. And then they're using two titles and an erroneous name, number two. And they're not putting anything in any kind of logical manner or perspective, you follow, to understand anything about that. They got John 5 and 17. The Lord, was that first? You got 1 John 5 and 7. They'll go here: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. That's where they spin in all that triangular, convoluted conversation about a Trinity. From this one chapter. It's the only place they go to see how they can get a three. They're not understanding that this three is actually one. And that one came down into a physical body in the earth plane by which we can see and explain it according to Moses' writings. That's why Moses is paramount down here. We're talking about the law, because he wrote your first five books. And then you got the prophets, the next 34 books, you follow? And then you don't forget about John. John's talking about what? The revelation of Yahshua. Now, John, Revelation 1 and 1. Mm-hmm. Remember, Moses wrote 5 books. John and I of Patmos wrote 5 books. And see, Yahweh gave him, he's the youngest of all the disciples. He's the beloved John. He's sitting up on this mountain, just as Moses is on this mountain. And he's surrounded by water. You follow? He's in a state of eternity, secluded by himself in prison. You follow? For the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Huh? And what did he say?
The revelation of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right there. Dr. Samuel Salas said that all of this is about Yahshua the Messiah. The first few words he said, it's all about Yahshua. Not you. Not your testimony of how you think you're going to feel better tomorrow or the next day. Because lo and behold, you're going to have you're going to get stepped on again. You're going to get a debacle again. It's bound to happen because Yahweh don't change until you change and get to know who Yahshua the Messiah is. This is all we're saying. Moses preached for 120 years, and this gospel has been being preached since 1930, 31, you follow? In whatever fashion, 1958, if you will. He was preached before 1958, prior to then, too. People don't realize that. With Lord God and Jesus Christ. But he was the only one able to do it like that. Mm-hmm. He being Dr. Kinley. You follow? And so now John is talking about this one Yahshua. About the revelation. Not shuns. Not plural. We ain't talking about a whole lot of things. That's why we ain't talking about you and me. We're only talking about one thing. And if you get tired of listening about that one thing, you're going to have a problem. But keep reading about Revelation. Again.
The revelation of Yahshua the Messiah, which Yahweh gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass.
Oh my, Yahweh gave that. See, Yahweh gave the vision to Dr. Kinley too. That's why he said, he of his own self didn't do nothing. John ain't done nothing. Moses ain't done nothing. Yahweh's doing it, putting it in them for us to know and find out about him. And when you know and learn about Yahshua Messiah, he put a hedge around you. He protects you. He gets you to do things. He gets you to answer the questions you pray on in order to receive the prayers you want, which is for his purpose, not your purpose no more, his purpose. That's the problem. Continue.
And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John.
Oh, he sent an angel to his servant John. Read.
Who bore record of the word of Yahweh.
See, he bore record. He's not talking about no written words neither. He's talking about the word Elohim. Huh? John know all about it. He's seen it. He seen him. He described him in his vision later on. That he's seen him walking down through the ages and the dispensations. When he turned to look. You follow? He know the Elohim. He know how to read Elohim. Keep reading.
And of the testimony of Yahshua the Messiah and of all the things that he saw.
All the things that he saw were about Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Blessed is he that readeth and they that hear the words of this prophecy.
See, you be blessed. Everybody talking about they blessed and highly favored. They ain't got a clue what they talking about. Bar none. It's almost, it's a sad state, huh? Yeah, it's just darkness. Blind leaving the blind. And they think they very close. They think they're so wrapped up in the spirit of things and the mighty Lord and all of that. But keep reading.
And keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand.
Since the time's at hand.
I am the first and the last.
He's the first and the last. Read. This angel done come to him now. And that angel saying he's the first and the last. Read.
The beginning and the ending.
Oh, there's a beginning. That's what I wanted to get. That beginning. See, Dr. Samuel Sellers said there was a beginning. There's many beginnings. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about this angel said he was the beginning. Huh? And that he's going to be the ending. It don't say Dr. Robert Harris up in there. It don't say Dr. Kinley up in there neither.
No, it doesn't.
The angel said that he was the beginning and he was going to be the ending. You follow? You want a bigger chart? He said he was going to be the beginning. Uh-oh, you're on the outside of this week, and then he was going to be the ending. He's on the outside of this whole skaboodle, and that was all about him. It's not about Henry Clifford Kinney at all. Not about Moses at all. You follow? It's all about Yahshua being the beginning and the ending. What else does angel say to John?
Said Yahweh Elohim, which is and which was and which is to, or has, which is to come.
That's three things.
Almighty.
That's three things. Was, is, and will be. Dr. Samuel Sala said one, two, three. He just gave you a rundown of he was, he is, and he's going to be. Keep reading.
John, to the seven assemblies which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead.
Oh. See, he's in this first. He's the first begotten of the dead. Mark that right there. You follow? Grab me Romans 5:14, I think it is. Mark that. Yahshua said he's the first begotten of the dead. He's resurrecting here because he was killed on that cross. He said it is finished, didn't he? John 19:20. It is finished. And then you have that burial for that day. And then you have him resurrected early part Sunday morning, correct? And he's resurrected. First fruits. First begotten of the dead. Dead of who? It's no question. And he's going to signify that he's the first of the dead from Adam. Read it.
Romans 5:14. Nevertheless,
yes.
Death reigned from Adam to Moses.
Look, the death reigned from Adam all the way to Yahshua the Messiah. He says Moses there, but we've come to realize and know that Moses here has received that Old Testament given to the children of Israel. True? Mm-hmm. We got a whole Moses chart. We're dealing with this fourth dispensation, this middle day within this 7 days of this dispensation. You follow? And in this period of time, you're going to have Yahshua Messiah become born within this fourth dispensation. That's why Saul is talking about from Adam unto Moses. But see, we're dealing with all of Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? We're dealing with that birth, death, and resurrection all about Yahshua the Messiah until this, because it's at this point that Yahshua is going to be the first fruit of the dead. These all were dead to the purpose of Yahshua. You see, now on this side of the cross, not dead anymore. You're sinning if you don't know Yahshua. I need a definition for, what is it? I think I want it. What is that word? Hold on, let me see. Let me think for a minute. So you got in Revelation, He's the first begotten of the dead, correct?
Right.
I'm letting you know what the dead were in Romans 5:14. From Adam all the way down to Moses, they were dead. It wasn't until Yahshua coming in that he's going to now fulfill, right, all of these things. Persons, places, and things. This is the fulfilling of what Yahshua does in 33 and a half years in order to bring all things to an end. In order so you might have life ever after, right? Because it's to have eternal life now,
right,
in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah. Not after you're dead. So they couldn't do that back here. Mm-hmm. They couldn't have eternal life now, you follow, in the kingdom. Because it was imposed on them.
Right.
And that's why Yahshua in Revelation is that he's the first of the dead. Mm-hmm. And I'm just letting you know what the dead that John's looking at.
Right.
And now we're going to go back to Revelation.
And and from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead.
Yes.
And the ruler of the kings of the earth.
Yes.
Unto him that beloved us.
Yes.
And washed us from our sins in his own blood.
See, in his own blood. And we got to see that that washing was the washing of regeneration. And that washing of regeneration that he performed as a type back here, before he took off that cross, before he got onto that cross, he was washing their feet in fulfillment of this washing that had to be done at this labor. You follow? This washing that had to be done at this, at this River Jordan. You follow? Mm-hmm. That's the washings that he have to be done in the blood. Keep reading.
And has made us kings and priests unto Yahweh his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever.
Mm-hmm.
Behold.
See, that's what we have the ability to now. You can't say you're sinning. You're sinning of Adam's sin? No. Yahshua fulfilled it. Dr. Samuel Salas said he nailed all of that. He even slapped the chart. And Dr. Samuel Salas don't usually slap the chart with a stick. He's letting you know that all of this that was given by Moses is no longer relevant. And this made sin exceedingly sinful. So that sin that we have now is the sin of not knowing who Yahshua Messiah is. It's not a textbook sin. You can't even read no new letters in your Matthew, in the scriptures there of the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They say Jesus told me so in red letters. And when you were Yahshua, Jesus said this. You can't put that on me. You don't even know that red letters was all happening back over here in the fourth dispensation. So someone said something to me. Ah, man, my time is out. Look, just to explain it real quick. Luke 24. I think my time is out, though. I'm not going to be able to catch this point. How much time is there, Aaron? It's already two.
The recording is 1:45, so 15 minutes.
Okay. Let's go ahead and use that marker. It's fine. Give me Luke. This is what I want to express. You know, someone expressed this the other day to me. I called somebody a fool, and right away they threw a scripture at me and said I shouldn't call people fools. You know, and I thought about it. Luke, was it 28? Huh? What? I'll find it in a minute. Yeah, Matthew 17. And then someone look up I'll get it on Webster Dictionary. Go ahead, you can get it.
Matthew 17.
Yeah.
From the beginning?
This is 5:17.
Oh, no, Matthew 5:17.
Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, it was Matthew 5. Matthew 5. I got 23. Go ahead and start reading and see what it say.
Matthew 5:1.
Yeah.
And seeing the multitude, he went up into the mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him, and he opened.
Okay, so go ahead and skip on down to 17. You had the Beatitudes there, right?
Right.
Okay, read.
Okay, 5:17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
That's
you want the Beatitudes? Merciful.
Yeah, where's my time? wanted to show this real quick. Fools. Matthew 5:22.
Matthew 5:22.
Get the definition for fool?
Yeah, just from the Google.
Just fine. You said it said judgment, right?
Judgment?
Yeah. Go ahead and read Eunice.
Okay. 5:22.
Imagine that. This is Yahshua the Messiah. He's walking around the Palestinian Judean hills, talking about these beatitudes. He's fulfilling the law of Moses by setting, you follow, becoming set on this mountain. Mm-hmm. And he begins to speak to them, fulfilling this first trip into the mountain is what we're reading here. Now go ahead, and we're at the end of all of this, and just catch it up and maybe at 21. And read.
21. You have heard that it was said by them of old time,
uh-huh,
thou shalt not commit murder.
There you go, right? Read.
And whosoever committed murder shall be in danger of the court of injustice.
Mm-hmm.
Of justice. But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother,
okay,
without a cause,
okay,
shall be in danger of the court of justice.
Okay.
And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be judged of the Sanhedrin. But whosoever shall condemn with a curse shall be in danger of the fire of Gehenna.
Okay.
Therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar,
mm-hmm,
and their remembrance that thy brother has ought against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar.
Okay.
And go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come offer thy gift. Agree with thine adversary quickly while thou art in the way with him, lest at any time the adversary deliver thee to the judge,
mm-hmm,
and the judge deliver thee to the officer, and thou be cast into prison.
Mm-hmm.
Verily I say unto thee,
mm-hmm,
thou shalt be by no means come out thence till thou hast paid the uttermost farthings.
Okay.
Ye have heard that it was said in them by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already in his heart.
What verse you on?
28.
Okay.
Keep going.
Go back up to 22.
22.
Mm-hmm.
But I say unto you that whosoever,
mm-hmm,
is angry with his brother,
yes,
without a cause,
yes,
shall be in danger of the court of justice.
You read now. You read now the holy name, huh?
Yeah. You want King James?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Got it.
Hmm. This is one of these heirs. Holy name don't have it in there. I'm listening for it, but so it's missing it.
And that's 5:22, yeah. King James.
Mm-hmm.
But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother,
mm-hmm,
without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment.
Yes. We're talking about judgment now, right?
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about judgment. We're talking about the judgment. People say the judgment is coming. The judgment is already happening now on earth. You follow? But we're reading Yahshua the Messiah talking to those people in the fourth dispensation. You follow? Now, someone's going to tell me about judgment as though God's going to be judging me, right, about what I'm doing. So keep reading.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire.
See, that's what I'm going to be in danger if I call a person,
oh,
a fool. I'm in danger of hell fire because I call some people fools. You follow? And they're saying, now, you can't say fool to somebody. But now, look at it. We just read in the scripture reading that that the New Testament is not written with pen and ink.
Right.
That it's going to be preached through a gospel. You follow? But yet someone's going to take me all the way back to Matthew and try to pin, I can't do this. I can't say that. But now look up the word fool, if you would. You have it?
Yep.
Go ahead and read. Now remind you, I just got done saying that from Adam all the way down to the Messiah, it says Moses in there, but I'm saying all the way to the Messiah until the cross, or really until Pentecost, they didn't know. They couldn't know nothing. It was imposed on them. So he's telling them, don't call one another fools because you can't judge. You follow? Read the definition for fool.
A person who lacks judgment.
A person who lacks what?
Judgment.
Judgment.
Or sense.
Or sense. That's all I need. Because those people had no ability to judge, and they didn't have no sense of who and what the Messiah was. But now, after the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and if you believe that, then you can judge. Mm-hmm. I can call a person a fool and let it be known that you're judged and that you're not looking at the things of Yahshua the Messiah. So you can't just pin that on me. Read. Read it in the mic.
Sorry.
A fool. This is a fool definition.
A person who has been deceived. A person who acts unwisely or imprudently. A silly person.
Hmm.
A person devoted to a particular activity.
Hmm. Being blinded. Being in Egypt, and that's an activity to be dwelling in this earth place in darkness. That's an activity of believing that your way is going to be the right way according to doing things. You follow? And that's an activity that people don't even want to get up. They don't even want to know about this chart no more. See, they're in an activity now, their own psychological, egotistical, misdirected personality. That's an activity. That's a way of life. That's what you believe in. Mm-hmm. Faking the funk and thinking you care. But you don't have the love of Elohim in you. Not really. That's fine. That's enough what I need for fool. And I'm just trying to show you that people are going to try to pin you on things and make you subject you to things in the book. They don't even know what age or dispensation they're in.
Right.
Saul tells Timothy, rightly divide the word of truth. Rightly dividing the word of truth is knowing about this ages and dispensation chart, or where are you at in this information? So when they put fool on me and you talk about the Beatitudes, well, you got me twisted.
Going back, yeah.
You got me twisted. Yeah. I'm not sitting at the base of no mountain listening to no law of Moses and listening to this Yahshua Messiah speak to me. He's talking to them.
Yeah.
See, when I'm corrected, I become as Yahshua the Messiah, you see? That's what we're teaching.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Kennedy said he's Yahweh. And the only difference what he said the difference was that he knew, fully aware and conscious of, which you're not.
Mm-hmm.
But hey, we've been in this teaching all this time to remain fools and to be main thinking that we're sinning. See, the only sinning is not knowing who Yahshua Messiah is. You follow? Because that's the one truth. That's what it's all about. And if you don't know Yahshua, that's a sin. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will be the end of our class for this morning. We have no announcements, right? Okay, we hold classes on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 to 9:30 and Sundays from 11 to 1. So can we all rise and be dismissed with the doxology?
I'll get the address.
Oh, and our address, we're located at 1816 East Elmo Court Ontario, California, 91764. Now, with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.